Welcome back. As we keep learning the big story of the Bible, let's review where we are. God created a good world. People sinned and followed their own way instead of God's way. Then God launched his rescue plan with what man? With Abraham. What three-part covenant did he make with Abraham? Grow his family into a huge nation, to give them their own land, and to bless the whole world through them. What part of that promise was fulfilled first? First, God gave Abraham a son when he was 100 years old and grew his family, his grandsons and his great-grandsons, into a nation. But that family was a nation living in Egypt. Who did God use to lead them out of Egypt? Moses. And last week, we talked about how in the desert, after God had brought the people out to himself, out to his special mountain, he made a covenant with them, with the whole people of Israel. What did God promise them? He promised to be their God, that they would be his special people, a nation of priests to bring his blessing and presence to the whole world. And what did the people promise to do? They promised to follow God's laws and not to have any other gods instead of him.
After traveling in the desert for 3 months, they came to Mount Sinai, and God called Moses from the top of the mountain. God spoke to Moses there of the future of his people and reminded him of the miracles of the past. After 3 days, there was thunder and lightning as a thick cloud covered the mountain. The people heard a loud trumpet blast. And Moses led people to the foot of the mountain to meet with God. God told them how his people were to live and how they were to honor him and respect each other. The Israelites had seen for themselves that God had spoken to Moses from heaven. These rules that God told them are called the Ten Commandments. And the Israelites feared God, for his mighty power had brought them out of slavery and provided for them in the desert.
Let's play a guessing game to see if you can remember the 10 really important laws that God gave the people of Israel. And I have a whole bunch of your kids' church teachers here to help us play that game.
Hi kids, how are you? We hope you're having a great time, and just wanted to say that we miss you, and we can't wait to see you when we can get back and meet together again at church. Mr. Jacob and I are going to enact one of the Ten Commandments for you, and I just want to remind you that no Mr. Jacobs will be harmed in the shooting of this video. All right, kids, what Ten Commandment was that?
Hi, it's Mr. Larry. I'm here with my wife, Catherine. And I was just thinking maybe instead of going to drive-in church, we could set up something out here that we can worship and, save us a bit of time and that. And if I set it up in the tree, see this, I thought maybe I could paint it in that and we could bow down and worship this on Sunday. What do you think, dear?
No. No, 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 no.
No?
No.
Okay. Bye.
Hi boys and girls, Miss Linnea here. I hope you guys are all staying safe and doing well. I'm going to be acting out one of the commandments. This is something you should not do.
morning, Kids Church kids. Miss Kathleen here. Hi, Kids Church kids. So great to see you, Callahan and Will, last Sunday. Can't wait to see more of you, Kids Church kids. Hope you're doing well. Can you guess which one of the Ten Commandments this is? You ready? Did you guess?
Hi guys, it's Miss Megan.
And Mr. Josh.
We can't wait to see you again. Hopefully the church opens back up so we can see all of you guys soon. So I'm going to act out a clue for one of the Ten Commandments, and you guys have to guess what it is. Oh man, our neighbor's house is so nice. And look at how big their yard is. If we had as nice of a yard and a house as them, we'd be so happy.
Did the people keep all those laws? Do you keep all those laws? No. Right away, they made a pretend god to worship right after they promised not to. But even though the people did not keep their promise, God was keeping his. In Exodus, what happened first? Did people promise to follow God and obey his commands, and then he saved them? No. God saved them, and then he made a covenant with them. He saved them, and then because he had saved them, then the people started to see that they could trust him. And then they promised to be his special people. The book of Exodus goes on, and the people follow God's instructions to build the tabernacle, a place where God's presence would be in a special way.
So we come to the end of the book. The tabernacle's built, God's presence comes down off the mountain to fill it, and in the final scene, Moses goes to enter the tabernacle to be in God's presence.
But he can't. He's actually not able to go inside, and that's how the book ends.
Why can't he go in? That was the whole point.
So when Israel worshiped the golden calf, it was like a slap in the face to God's faithfulness. And so Moses can't just waltz into the tent like everything's just fine. There's a deeper problem still in this relationship.
Will they ever be able to fix the relationship and go into God's presence?
Well, that's what the next book, Leviticus, is all about.
Book number 3 is the book of Leviticus, and it tells the story of how the people would be able to actually enter the tabernacle through the priests and the animal sacrifices and meet with God. And it includes many instructions God gave for how they could do that and other instructions so that their people could be God's special people.
And so God's presence comes to dwell in a tent right in the middle of Israel.
And that's great.
But it creates a problem because it's so intense that Moses can't go in and other priests who enter inappropriately, they die.
Well, wait, if God's presence is good, how is it all of a sudden dangerous for people?
So think of it this way. God's presence is like the sun. It's pure power and goodness. And when something mortal and corruptible gets close to such pure power, it's destroyed. And so the word holiness is used in Leviticus to describe God's pure and powerful presence, which, like the sun, is both good and dangerous. So the point of Leviticus is to show how corrupt Israelites can live near God's goodness without being destroyed.
So that's Leviticus. But Israel's still at Mount Sinai in the middle of the wilderness. They need a place to live.
Yes, the land God promised to Abraham. And so the journey to that land is what the next book of the Bible is all about.
Book number 4 is the book of Numbers. It tells the story of Israel on their way to the special land that God promised them to Abraham, from the mountain to going in and crossing the Jordan River.
The book of Numbers gets overlooked, partly because it has a really boring name.
Which is a shame. In the Hebrew tradition, the book's name is Bamidbar, which means in the wilderness. And it's an epic travelogue about Israel's journey through the desert on their way to the land promised to Abraham.
Now, this pilgrimage should only take about 2 weeks on foot.
But instead, it takes them about 40 years.
That's crazy. It's practically half of someone's lifetime.
Yeah, it's a very long camping trip with lots of interesting stories, but it's not great. After just 3 days on the road, the people are complaining about their hunger and thirst, and then even Moses' brother and sister start bad-mouthing him in front of all the people.
Not a great start. But now we're into the third section, the wilderness of Paran. This is where they send the 12 spies to scout out the promised land. Two of those spies come back and they're really optimistic.
But the other 10 are freaked out and they don't trust God and they go around saying, we're gonna get annihilated in there. And so they start a mutiny and they try to appoint a new leader who's gonna take all the people back to Egypt. And so basically they are refusing to go into the promised land and God honors their choice. He says that this generation is going to wander for 40 years and die in the wilderness, and only their kids will get to enter the promised land.
You know, this story here gets brought up many times in the Bible by different authors.
Yeah, and it always serves as a reminder that while God remains faithful to his people and his promises, he will honor their choices. He'll let them waste their whole lives if they choose to live in rebellion.
The next book is the book of Deuteronomy. This is when the people are finally about to go into the land promised to Abraham. And Moses reminds them of the covenant they had made in a final speech he gives them. He tells them and reminds them about all the things that they promised in the covenant, the laws that God had given him. And he tells them that he and God know they will break the covenant. He knows they will start worshiping other gods. They will trust the snake, the sin, their own way. And after Moses gives this big speech, he goes up onto the mountain and he dies. Do you know who will lead the people after him? His name is Joshua. If Moses was like Batman, then Joshua would have been like his Robin, his sidekick, his helper. He had seen what the Lord did through Moses. And now God calls Joshua to lead the people. Do you know what book of the Bible that happened in? Joshua! God used Joshua to lead the people to fulfill the second part of his promise to Abraham. What is that part of the promise? God would use Joshua to fulfill the promise that Abraham's family would have the land that God had brought Abraham to when he left his original country. And here, they were about to cross the Jordan River into the promised land after 40 years in the desert. They were really, really looking forward to it.
It's time?
It's time? Did he just say it's time?
We didn't have a lot of fun in the desert. We didn't have a lot of fun in the sand. But saddle up your cow and look behind us now.
Because we're going to the promised land.
For years I've eaten nothing but manna. A dish that is filling but bland.
But now we're on our way.
I'll have a taste to play.
Because we're going to the promised land. And in the promised land it's gonna be so grand. We'll have our fill from the grill as much as we can stand. It'll be so great, oh we can hardly wait. Cause we're going to the promised land.
The dining was loosey with Moses, but we'll be feasting with Josh in command.
I'd like a taco, please, and some pinos and cheese.
Because we're going to the promised land. And
in the promised land. It's gonna be so grand. We'll have our fill from the grill as much as we can stand. It'll be so great, oh, we can hardly wait, 'cause we're going to the promised land. And in the promised land,
sticky.
'Cause we're going to the promised land. Yeah, we're going to the promised land. 'Cause we're going to the promised land.
I hope you enjoyed that irritating little song from my childhood. And if you just got my last joke, you definitely grew up a church kid in the 90s. But anyways, the book of Joshua tells the story of how God leads the people to drive out the people in the land to take it for themselves. Like when God brought down the walls of Jericho when they marched around it. Maybe you know that story.
Joshua is a medium-sized book with 24 chapters that divide into four parts. Part one is about Joshua finally leading the Israelites across the Jordan River and into Canaan, the promised land.
And once again, God parts the waters so they can walk through on dry land.
And fight they did. King after king in city after city. The first big city they fought was Jericho. You've heard of Jericho, right?
That's where God knocked the walls down.
That certainly showed that he was fighting with them.
Yep, and he kept fighting with them all throughout the promised land until God's promise of their own land had come true.
Before the people started actually living in the promised land, building farms and building homes, Joshua, like Moses had done, reminded the people again of the covenant they and their fathers before them had made with God. Now fear the Lord, Joshua said, and serve him with all faithfulness. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable, seems not good to you, then choose for yourself this day who you will serve. Will you serve the gods of your grandfather and your grandmother that they served back in Egypt? Or will you serve the gods of the people who live around you in whose land you're living? But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. What do you think the people said to Joshua? All the people said to Joshua, "We will serve the Lord our God and obey him." But did the people keep their promise?
The Book of Judges. So remember, after Joshua led the tribes of Israel into the promised land, he called them to be faithful to their covenant with God by obeying the commands of the Torah. And if they do this, they will show all the other nations what God is like. So Judges begins with the death of Joshua and basically tells the story of Israel's total failure. The book's name comes from the type of leaders Israel had in this period. Before they had any kings, the tribes were all governed by these judges. Now, don't think of a courtroom. These were regional political military leaders, more like a tribal chieftain. And you need to be warned, the book of Judges is very disturbing and violent. It tells the tragic tale of Israel's moral corruption, of its bad leadership, and basically how they become no different than the Canaanites. But this sad story is also meant to generate hope for the future. And you can see this in how the book's designed. There's a large introduction that sets the stage for Israel's failure as they don't drive out the remaining Canaanites. Then the large main section of the book has stories about the growing corruption of Israel's judges. And the progression here shows how Israel's leaders go from pretty good to okay to bad to worse. The concluding section is really disturbing and shows the corruption of the people of Israel as a whole.
When the people who had been with Joshua and seen what God had done died, their children didn't keep the covenant. They started worshiping other gods, idols. We talked about this last week. What did all the people living around them, like the people in Egypt, believe? They believe that there were lots of gods, and that each god, which they represented with an idol or a statue or an image, was in charge of different things. Like one god that was in charge of money, and if you didn't have money, you could ask that god to help you. And one god that was in charge of having lots of babies, and a god in charge of human love, and a god in charge of your farm going really well and your plants growing. Do we still worship other gods today? Most people we know don't worship idols or believe in the same kinds of many gods that Israel's neighbors believed in. But we all very often trust in the same things that these gods represented. Instead of trusting in God, we think money or human love or a perfect family or good friends will make us happy and safe. And we think that being happy or being safe are like gods, are like the most important thing in our life to go after. Adults, you're probably gonna have to go first, but let's have everyone in the family share a god that they worship. Something that you trust to make you happy or safe, or something that you spend most of your time and energy chasing after. When the people were finally in the promised land, that was great and flowing with milk and honey, they forgot that God was really the one who had kept them safe and gave them that land.
And so began a great cycle.
What kind of cycle? A unicycle?
No, a great cycle of misery. A cycle of apostasy.
Apostasy? Who? Apostasy, a fancy word that means to walk away from what you believe, to abandon your beliefs.
That's right. And so the cycle began. First, the Israelites would forget all about God and start worshiping the fake gods of their neighbors. Then, God would take away his protection and his blessing from Israel, just like he'd promised back in Deuteronomy. A neighboring king would then come in and take over part of Israel and make their lives miserable. In misery, the children of Israel would call out to God for help, and God would answer. He would raise up a judge, a leader filled with God's spirit and God's power, who would drive out their enemy and free the Israelites once again. The Israelites would celebrate how God had saved them, but then get lazy and go right back to worshiping the fake gods of their neighbors, and the whole thing would start over again.
They must have learned a little each time, right? So each time they went around, they weren't quite as bad?
Actually, it was just the opposite. Each time God raised up a judge to get him out of trouble, they'd forget him again and start doing stuff that was even worse.
That's right. By the end of the Book of Judges, the Israelites had broken their covenant with God in every way imaginable. Some of the tribes of Israel were even killing each other. They were making idols. And some of the Levites, God's priests in Israel, were helping the other tribes worship the idols instead of God. The cycle of apostasy went down and down and down.
Israel went through this cycle with 12 different judges. Now, this is a tricky question, but can you name any of them? You might know some of their stories.
Yeah, but who were the judges?
Well, you've got Othniel and Ehud, Shamgar and Deborah, Gideon and Tola, Jair and Jephthah. Who could forget about old Ibzan, or Elon and Abdon, and the most famous of them all, that long-haired dude named Samson.
He was strong.
And the judges themselves got worse and worse. God still used them to rescue his people. But the later judges did not lead the people back to God. They themselves even worshiped other gods. But God still used them. Does this cycle feel like something you can relate to? Have you ever done something really bad? Or something really selfish? Or something you knew you weren't allowed to do? But there was something you really wanted and so you did it anyway? But then you got caught. And you got in trouble. Or the bad thing that you did made something bad happen. And in that moment, you say to yourself or you say to your parents, I'll never do that again. And the trouble goes away. and life goes on, and then things are good again. And you forget how bad it was when you did that bad thing. And something happens again that you promised you'd never do. And then you think, now I've learned my lesson. Now I'll never do it again. But you do. Aren't you tired of that? I am. I can think of a couple things I do like this. I hear the lie like, you won't surely die. It won't be that bad. Like the snake lied to Eve in the garden about eating the fruit. I trust my own way and I do what seems right in my own eyes in that moment, again and again and again. What about you? What do you keep doing like this? Adults, you'll probably need to share first. Something had to change for Israel. And something has to change for us. The last verse in Judges says, in those days, there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes. Something needed to happen. Judges shows us how badly the people needed a king. Next week, we'll learn about the king of Israel. Do you think the kings were better leaders than the judges? Do you think they were about to lead the people to keep their covenant with God? No. They were even worse. And the people were attacked even worse than they were with the judges. And they were carried away into captivity, just like Moses said they would be. But God's plan was at work. And one day, the only perfect leader, the perfect covenant keeper, the perfect king would come. Who was it? Jesus would come and he would break the cycle. He would break the cycle of trying hard to be good and failing and trying again and failing and again and again. Remember how God saved Israel first through the Red Sea before they ever kept his covenant or promised to? That's what God does for you too through Jesus. Because of Jesus, you can be close to God in his presence. You can become a child of God without having to be good enough. You don't have to worry that God will stop loving you when you fail. And because of Jesus, we will never be exiled. We will never be kicked out of his presence. When we trust Jesus to save us, he makes us part of his kingdom. We get to start living with him right now, and he starts to change our hearts. Not by us trying harder, but by us being with him, by knowing him more. We get to see that he's trustworthy, and so we are less tempted to trust in other things. Here's the thing. Lots of you boys and girls really do already love Jesus and really do trust him. And lots of you moms and dads, and me too, have trusted him for a long time. And he has broken the cycle in your life, and yet you still feel like you're stuck in this cycle. You feel like you have to try hard, and then you fail, and you ask God for help, and you aren't good enough. And you know what? For a lot of your life, you're probably going to feel stuck in this. Jesus has set you free from the cycle, and freedom from the cycle is the freedom you've been set free for. But even though Jesus has broken the power of sin and crushed the power of sin on the cross, it's still got a hold on our world. And every day is a struggle to trust Jesus and not our own ability to be good. But one day we will get to enter the true and better promised land. One day, High King Jesus will return. And like he rose from the dead, he will bring all his children back and he will resurrect the world, a new heaven and a new earth. Can you imagine it? Dear Jesus, thank you that your love for us doesn't depend on us being good. Thank you that we don't have to earn it. Thank you that we can just trust you, that you love us, and you want us to be your children, and you actually love it that we're your children. Help us to trust you, not our own goodness or any other gods. Help us to only trust you. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Thanks for joining us this week, everybody, and let's announce this week's contest winner! Thanks, everybody, for participating, and I can't wait to see what you guys come up with for this week. Don't forget to register for day camp. August 17th is the Monday we start. It's going to be a week of awesomeness, and the sooner we get everyone signed up, the sooner we can jump in to start planning and preparing for it. See you next week!